presentation that really sang to me in that presentation of 7 years ago, I was around the corner. Without a footing, will we still discuss epistemology in this philosophy without ground that we've been exploring? And I hope we will continue to explore this precious space. I was, despite what Paul has said, I was very conscious of your imperious sovereignty in imposing this artistic vision on us. I was reminded, actually, of an anecdote which relates to one of the most famous exceptional spaces in Britain, which is the maze of Hampton Court, only a few hundred yards away on the other side of the river, you know, is Hampton Court Palace. And the greatest visionary Shakespeare designer of the 20th century who grew up near here, Edward Gordon Craig, describes in his autobiography, The Edicts of the Story of My Days, how his dream as a young boy and as a budding designer was to stand in the central turret of the maze and then observe the tourists after he had taken the entrance away and register their terror. Of course, there's a very close relationship between Craig's designs and the Nuremberg rallies. Albert Speer's famous cathedral bike was inspired by Edward Gordon Craig. So all day long, I think we've been thinking about the aporia between sovereignty and democracy in ways that this presentation asked us to do. Many of us refused to march in the way that our sovereign had asked us to do, and went in counterclockwise for our own. This aporia which you've all been involved in today between democracy and sovereignty, which as Paul rightly reminds us, is of the nature of this space, of the nature of this experience. Sovereign is he who decides the conclusion. And as the invisible old fantastical Duke of Dark Corners, who has not been going out to pray, like a lion, or an aged lion in my cave, I've been lurking in the corner like the Duke of Measure all day long. I now exercise my right. To remind you, as you just have been, about the institutional privileges that were here, in this summer of London, which is neither in London nor outside London, this liminal space, in this gallery, which is neither in a theatre nor out of the theatre, in this intellectual and academic space which occupies the same liminality towards the university too, it's neither owned by the university nor is it owned by the theatre. We've all been thinking all day about the meaning, I think, of the bonia, the suburb, the outside law, the outlaw, in highly productive ways that we really owe to the special privilege of this Rose and Peter Hall's vision, actually, in bringing academics and actors together in this strange liminal space when he created this theatre, this Rose. So, we've also been thinking, and Stephanie, in her imperious way, brought a shark there up against me, of the sovereignty within democracy, this strange paradox that democracy has to degenerate into sovereignty. And of course, we've also been thinking about the way which sovereignty degenerates or transforms into democracy. This two-way process, which has been part of our thinking all day long. But I think if there's a dark thread that runs through this labyrinth, and of course, Stephanie's maze reminds us of how significant labyrinths and mazes, not very Midsummer's Dream are, as a kind of what Jack called, I think, very productively, a working model. Theatre as a working model of a democratic space. That is at the same time under the regime of the sovereign, like Edward Gordon Craig. If there is a dark theme running through, it has been that we have been questioning deeply the illusion that we may have that there are sovereign spaces, exceptional experiences outside the law, because again and again we've been reminded that those spaces of asylum, which appear to be heterotopic spaces, appear to be the green world in traditional criticism, are themselves darkly shadowed by sovereignty. If there was one theme I thought that came through very strongly in that great presentation we had on Lear, it is that when Leo goes into the wilderness, he discovers to his surprise that the wilderness is always already owned, and that sovereignty is there. There are no green spaces, because those dunes have got it all carved out. And that sense that these hot heterotrophic spaces of the silence was never more evident, I think, than in the discussion that we had on Comedy of Errors, a play that I mentioned, that has kept coming back. The sense that asylum, that priory, is itself close to power, is one that Shakespeare never lets us forget. He never lets us forget it in all kinds of tropical resonances. Most crucially, of course, that place of death and sorry execution behind the ditches of the Abbey here is one of Shakespeare's topical references to the execution of the Jesuit priest William Hartley beside Holywell Abbey, which is now the theatre where the players are performing. So the sense in which not only is that priory from which the abbess comes, Holywell, now a sorry place of death and execution, but is also the place of the theatre. Something that we've been reminded of in so many recent books. I recommend particularly Andrea Sofia's book, Man on the Sacrifice, Scaffold, and Animality in Shakespeare. The proximity of Shakespeare's stage to the sorry place of death and execution, and the whole Catholic experience, which has been hovering, haunting the day's proceedings, is one that we're reminded of from the very beginning, and of course is central to contemporary Shakespeare studies. At the beginning of the day, of course, we were reminded of a topicality of our own, which is the current state of emergency in France. But I was reminded that one of the greatest practitioners of the Republican monarchy, which the Fifth Republic is constitutionally, as opposed perhaps you might say to our monarchic republic, one of the greatest practitioners of that, the most imperious and sovereign war president, François Mitterrand, actually before he became a convert to the Fifth Republic, in 1958 famously described de Gaulle's constitution for the Fifth Republic in a pamphlet as a permanent state of emergency. The Fifth Republic is a permanent state of emergency because of the executive sovereign power that is in this installed precisely in order to escape the parliamentarianism of what should be called the chatter of the Fourth Republic. So Mitterrand's description, which of course came back to haunt him, has been haunting my mind all day that the Fifth Republic is a public state of emergency, so who would be surprised? Who would be surprised? As if we should be surprised the liberal democracy that represents itself, Western democracy, is riven with these dark, violent contradictions. The line that spoke to me from Macbeth in particular was that disingenuous line of Lady Macbeth after the murder, when she pretends to be surprised and said, "What, in our house? In our house, even in the Comedy of Errors and the Merchant of Venice? In our place of love, even we reminded, after all, we couldn't help but think in that late paper on Macbeth and the great lecture on Macbeth, in fact, that Macbeth is one of the world's greatest love stories. With Romeo and Juliet, it's one of the ones that actors love to play. And always play highly erotically. So what, in our house? And this sense that even our most heterotrophic spaces and highest dreams and delusions are haunted by violence, and by the violence of their own origins, is of course never more specific than Macbeth, where even in the gentle wheel, the state was founded in love, and there is always already love in that play. That play, perhaps, isn't coincidentally at the centre of his proceedings, because it seems to be the one where Shakespeare comes closest to the face of power. It does, of course, in The Mask of the Stupid Kings, when, if the editors and the historicist critics are right, the eighth of the Stupid Kings presented to Macbeth in The Mask, which is Mary Queen of Scots. And in that great litany of violence that Martin Davis, of the history of the Stuart family, one fact he didn't mention is that the Mary Queen of Scots execution was as a result of the connivance of her own son, who was present there at Hampton Court in the Great Hall with his brother King Christian on August 6th, 1606, when Arthur got out of court, how Macbeth was performed. So that the mirror there, which is presented to the king in the Great Hall, asking him to confront his own face, presents James I and his own connivance in assassination and slaughter, a matricide indeed, on which the British state is founded, the United Kingdom is founded. All the way through Macbeth, of course, this extraordinary play which has two kings, two kingdoms, two courts, two feasts, two of everything, double trouble, reminds us that today's terrorists will be tomorrow's freedom fighters. Shakespeare often, however, rather beautifully describes the Jesuit plotters, the terrorists, as fools of time, who died for goodness, though they lived for crime. Today's terrorists will be tomorrow's freedom fighters. That one has died for goodness, though today they lived for crime. This seems to be explicit and expressed to Shakespeare's relationship to the gunpowder plot, out of which the doubleness and the equivocation and the sense in Macbeth comes that state terrorism and terrorism mirror each other. This, of course, makes me think very obviously of a name that has resonated in my mind, but has hardly, I think, ever been mentioned during the day, which is Jack Derrida's name. And I think what Derrida was doing when he engaged so controversially with Schmidt in his book on rogues was to remind us that sense of the doubleness of sovereignty and democracy, but also the plurality of sovereignty. That sovereignty is, as Eric really said, I think, in his description of the technicity of the of law and the liberal democratic state, everywhere but nowhere. It cannot, in that sense, be considered the Merchant of Venice grounded our thinking today. Of course, I should have spoken at the very beginning of the sense that we were reminded today because of the extraordinary, intense, structuralist account, first of all, of thou and you, and then of the social network in The Merchant of Venice, that Shakespeare is conscious, perhaps more than any other dramatist, that language is a system of differences, and that Shakespeare's exceptionalism is in some sense exceptionally connected to his awareness of language as a system of differences, built into his binarism, the duality of his plots between the court and the country, between the city and the greenwood, and of course in every part of Shakespeare's, every paronomasia functions for Shakespeare precisely in these deeply structuralist terms. So it wasn't for nothing that Derrida said he wished he'd become a Shakespeare critic at the very time that he was engaging with Schmidt around questions of sovereignty. So Catholicism has been a dark thread running through the play, or rather the violence of Catholicism that was at the centre of Shakespeare's biographical experience. And I was struck very strongly during the discussion, the wonderful lecture we had on Macbeth, by the irony of the fact that the Jesuit terrorists, who after all were the Al-Qaeda of the day, I think there's no doubt that they did intend to destroy the entire English establishment. At the moment of the foundation of the United Kingdom, had the bomb gone off, you asked the wonderfully hypothetical question, what would it have been like if it had gone off? Well, the French had already had 30,000 killed in 1572 in this, but one was no massacre. The 9/11 of Shakespeare's lifetime, where Shakespeare, as a young man growing up in a Catholic world in Warwick, must have felt very strongly the counterblast of the massacre of 30,000 Protestants, Huguenots, on the streets of Paris. So I think Antonia Fraser's remark in her book, The Gunpowder Plot, 1605, that it would have been a golden age, but she's a pious Catholic, if the plot had gone off, is contradicted by Macbeth itself. Surely Macbeth is the play that answers your question. You suggested this there. Macbeth is the play that answers the question. What would have happened? Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. Well, in his book on philosophy after terror, you know, the conversation of Habermas, Derrida says that what distinguishes the terrorist from the democrat is that the terrorist has no future. Has, and of course, maybe Macbeth have no future. They have a permanent and eternal present. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow will never come for them. Whereas the democrat must always look towards the arrogance of what is to come. What is to come. come in the comedies comes through these places of asylum, which may be compromised, but the rogues return at the end of Azuraika and the end of the comedies, even though the places they've gone to, the asylums, are compromised in ways, for example, that Jaques represents. At the end of Azuraika, Jaques says that he, out of these compromises, there is much matter to be learned. He's punning on martyr. He's punning on martyr. Just as Paulina has gone in The Winter's Tale to that chapel, where I thought she had some great martyr there in hand. The great mother, of course, in that chapel. This Catholic redoubt is a place that will produce the gunpowder plot. Jaques will be the gunpowder plot. There is Jaques, you saw him in his hat. He's Robert Kingston. He's one of the other conspirators. So we shouldn't imagine that those places of asylum and indeed those happy endings aren't shadowed, aren't darkened by the violence that we've been following always through the day. After Macbeth, I think, or at the time of Macbeth, through Measure for Measure in particular, Shakespeare is exploring precisely the way sovereignty decays into democracy. Now, it's a kind of cliche criticism that Shakespeare must have been appalled by the moment where sovereignty disintegrates and is mocked, and the multitudinous, the hydra-headed multitude exercises its wavering indecision. But it seems to me that in the first half of Measure for Measure, what we get in this Presbyterian state is not only a deep meditation on execution, defining sovereignty as the right to take life, decapitation, even, of course, as we've already seen in Macbeth, that we have decapitation at the beginning, we have decapitation at the end, we have Macdonald's film at the beginning, and we have Macbeth's head at the end, so the entire play is bookended by this question, what bloody man is that? We also have, I think, in the first half of Measure for Measure, a sense that liberty plucks justice by the nose, in a state where sovereignty has no head, a state of substitutions and endless displacements in which everybody is a deputy for everybody else. The kind of Presbyterianism, in fact, that James hated in Scotland. I think this is where our editor colleagues must come in and remind us that the second half of the play, and you might say the second half of Shakespeare's life, turns on the intervention of Thomas Middleton and the extraordinary absolutist Eric would say, Baroque statement. He who the sword of heaven must bear should be as holy as severe, patterning himself alone, grace to stand and virtue go. Well, there's an astonishing modern sense of the subjectivity of the autonomous self-identical self with the absolutist sovereign. The coterminous relationship there between the sovereign self and the sovereign monarch in the absolutist state is extraordinarily predictive of everything that we were hearing about in terms of a Hobbesian universe, certainly. A Hobbesian universe of dog-eat-dog. A Shakespearean intimation of what Spinoza identifies as the essential bestiality and animality. Whatsoever an individual does, says Spinoza, later in the century, by the laws of its nature, it has a sovereign right to do. The market rationale, whatsoever an individual does, by the laws of its own nature, it has a sovereign right to do. But also a sense that, as a century on, Rousseau will remind us, democracy is never more democratic than it is when it is misgoverned. And without the capacity to be misgoverned, and to go around, and to pluck liberty, and for liberty to pluck justice by the nose, without, that is to say, breaking the law, democracy itself would not be sovereign. And for Rousseau, in social contract, it's precisely the breakdown of law when liberty plucks justice by the nose. Everything that Shakespeare's aristocrats despise is celebrated in century on by Rousseau in social contract as the very definition of sovereignty, of popular sovereignty. It's an irony, of course, that popular sovereignty is evolved by Jesuits in relation to their tyrannicide thing. The first thing is a popular sovereignty are Jesuits around the gunpowder plot, like Robert Parsons, arguing that the Elizabethans have the right to elect their next monarch. So even the concept of popular sovereignty is darkly implicated, but Rousseau is surely right when it comes to Shakespeare criticism,
that it's precisely when sovereignty, when democracy breaks, when it breaks sovereignty, and when government breaks down, that democracy is most sovereign. Most sovereign when liberty plucks justice by the nobles. So we haven't only heard that law, as Simon says, law in its rough power has unchecked theft. That sense that consequence reminds us of John, King John. I was very pleased to see King John, the Magna Carta play, come through earlier in the day. That law can do no right. We haven't only learned that. But we've also learned that when law can do no right and liberty plucks justice by the nose and law in its rough power has unchecked theft, popular sovereignty is being exercised. Although, of course, it may be exercised in terror, the September massacres. It may be exercised in that Jacobean and Robespierrian sense. That is the risk of the Shakespearean play as a working model of a democracy, or let us say, a state without sovereignty. A state without sovereignty that must begin with a working model itself. It cannot therefore be chance that as after Macbeth, after this, and after the collaboration, the imposed collaboration with Middleton, of whom there is never a more absolutist artist. It's a mistake to think that simply because Middleton was a Puritan, he wasn't a believer in absolutism. This is an absolutist puritanical state that Middleton is imposing on the second half of Measure for Measure. After that moment, Shakespeare seems to return to the scheme, the project of self-effacement, self-erasure as an artist that will take us to the Tempest. It's true that, as Agamben constantly reminds us, the Tempest is the prototypical concentration camp. The idea that it's a utopian exile, a space of freedom and paradise, was long crushed by Jan Kopp, who reminded us that the whole history of the world is repeated with all its violence and its genocide on Prospero's Island. Prospero's Island, which is always already owned. Caliban, of course, himself was a colonist on Prospero's Island. When he arrived from Algiers with his mother. Always already owned, and always in that sense of a model of a concentration camp, or let's call it an internment camp. But it isn't coincidental that many critics believe the Tempest was inspired by that Mediterranean island of fire and storms, Lampedusa, which is now the liminal space of all, above all the internment camp between North Africa and Italy. Lampedusa, a model for, surely, for any future production of the Tempest. But out of that Tempest comes a sense that the theatre itself, as a working model, has the capacity to deconstruct its own violence, to envisage a future that will leave a state which will leave not a rat behind. In that sinister pun there, where Shakespeare ties his own theatre, that's to say, the rack of the preceding stage, the machinery of the Stuart mask, with the worst instruments of the torture machine. The machine that, terrifyingly, as Eric Hanser says, seems to run for itself. The machine in that Schmittian image, the wonderful creation we had at the beginning of the day, that will run for itself. Shakespeare seems in the Tempest to envisage an escape from that, in an escape from the authority of the artist, for sure, but also the obscenity, the self-identity of the autonomous individual that Prospero is. When in his epilogue he asks us, as you've been trying to embody me, let your indulgence set me free, the autonomous individual who is also the absolutist mind. And I like to believe that if this seminar is about anything, it is a sense of thinking through Shakespeare as a future, as a hospitable space without illusions, but where the future is still to come. I'm reminded and struck this morning by the rather, to our minds, difficult, complex problem of Portia when she disguises herself as Balthazar. Balthazar, the third king, the black king, who connects the play, that in that sense, to the whole tradition, which is so intrinsic to the theatrical history of the Silent and Escape into the Greenwood Spectre, of blacking, which of course in Shakespeare in England was a statement that we go to liberty, not banishment, as Celia says when she smirches her face with amber. I've yet to see a production that does it, but surely the disguise as Balthazar, the surprise black king who comes into the nativity story, parodied now in the Dutch traditions of Black Peter, that are very much in the news, that surprise black magus who appears on all the stained glass windows and the great Renaissance paintings of the Nativity. The real intimate, the real astonishing presence in the Nativity story is the men taken by Portia, when she is neither a lawyer nor a layman, when she's neither a boy nor a girl, when she's not self-identical, when she is both the same and the other. At that moment, just before the play closes down and returns us to a world where the machine runs itself so depressingly, in Eric's Schmittian description, and a world that still belongs to an Advent faith, a belief in an open future, a belief that the stranger who comes with the black face is not an image of oppression and empire and colonialism, but as an image of promise and hope and future and true hospitality. A sense, that's to say, that I would like us to all take away from this special suburban banlieue here, where we have come from places of real emergency. We've come from Greece, and we've come from exceptionally bizarre volcanic spaces like Iceland, which is a whole island of exception, and we've actually come from Bangalore, which is a state of exception if there ever were one, this contradictory, oxymoronic space that is neither Serbia nor Bosnia. We've come here, we've convened, we've brought our own experiences in wonderful ways, productive ways today. I hope you will leave Kingston with a sense that what's to come is still unsure.